I will basically take a broad sweep. You know, in ITP we have been engaging with canal irrigation from the day one. We have reviewed literature, we have done our own studies. And I really feel that we are back to square one. Our kind of tentative conclusion is that there is enormous scope for getting more value out of the public investments that we made in canal irrigation. But you don't see any sign of such attempts, such efforts being made. So that brings us back to the square one. What is the problem in canal irrigation? And I'm not sure if they figured it out. What we often talk about are really symptoms. You know, for example, the point that I was made in the morning about investments, about irrigated area not being in place with investments. I think that's one of the symptoms, just as there are many other symptoms. And these are symptoms of the public system becoming increasingly irrelevant to its client or to its customer. And that is becoming evident in a variety of different ways. Number one, the command areas of irrigation systems have remained inelastic with respect to public investment. No matter how much you invest, the total areas commanded by the irrigation system don't seem to grow very fast with the investment. There is a build, neglect, rebuild syndrome that has become a part of the canal irrigation system. If you build a new canal irrigation, you then start neglecting it as soon as you build, and in 5 to 7 years, it's ready for rehabilitation and modernization. In many other countries, in Sri Lanka, for example, there are cases where even before one rehabilitation program gets over, another has been funded by some government. Now, this is not how any asset is supposed to perform. When you build a new asset, they will create services. For services, you earn certain revenue and use that revenue to maintain and to improve the system over time. So, earn, maintain, grow should be the normal path for a new irrigation asset to take, not merely neglect, rebuild over and over again. Persistence of data equity, all canal irrigation areas have this problem. Very low irrigation service fee, and that too very poor recovery of whatever service fee is needed. A very important indicator is that there is a shrinking of rights paid to canal managers almost everywhere. In 1970s, Robert Day made a career out of studying right payments by canal irrigation officials in Andhra Pradesh. But today, nowhere do you see large scale. What does it mean? It basically means that the service that the irrigation managers are offering are no longer in great demand. There is a huge boom in canal commands, which is one reason why the product is shut. So farmers are voting by the feet rather than by the voice. They are not saying that the service that you are providing us is not adequate. Instead, they are creating their own private organisms. There is little or no verifiable information on performance. Actually, so many of us have been saying for the last several years that command areas are not doing. There are a lot of protests against that. But nobody is putting alternative evidence. And no, this is not true. Here is an alternative set of numbers which show that irrigated areas are growing or irrigated, which means that there is nobody is able to bother about the performance of this entire set. The primary interest is in constructing, building more and more systems in brick and mortar and not in money. So public irrigation systems tend to be very different in reality compared to their design. Most irrigation systems in India, even designed during the colonial period, were designed to spread limited amount of water over large areas. And in the post-independence area, also the same design is being followed because planners won't justify investments in dams by showing a very large command area. But in actuality, most irrigation systems become like this. There is a core command along near the reservoir and along the main canal, which tends to use much more water than it needs, and you have very dry areas as well. And one major area is where management improvement is needed is here. And there are studies which show, one of them was submitted to ITP for this meeting, that it does not require a farthing of investment to move from here to here. The case study that was submitted, unfortunately those engineers couldn't come, But this is from Mahi Bajaj Sagar in southern Rajasthan. In 99, that system faced the area faced a drought, and therefore the politicians in the area, they created a huge ruckus and they started putting pressure on the engineers to expand the irrigation or irrigated area as much as possible. So this is what happened. The amount of water that this system, the reservoir had kind of shrunk to almost 50% of its previous years. So in 1999, the amount of water available was just 50%. But the area that was irrigated increased by 60%. And the average reservoir water per hectare came down from 1.5 to 1.6 meter depth to about 0.8 depth. 0.8 depth itself is very high depth. I mean, a hectare of wheat would take 4,500 or 5,000 cubic meters. And you will need 8,000 cubic meters of water. But even that was a great achievement, because earlier they were providing 15,000 cubic meters for cultivation. What did they need to do this? Just consult to the farmer leaders on the reservoir. Take farmer leaders, take them to the reservoir, show them that look, this time we don't have half as much water as we normally have. Number two, those water schedules, the agricultural scientists and the canal irrigation managers came together and they figured out which are the periods during which water needs to be released. And the water release schedule was changed to fit this. Number three, intensive information, education, communication campaign was launched with farmers in order to encourage farmers to reseal canals. A very simple operation. Activating and involving different water users associations in water distribution. And imposing a whole homegrown kind of environment. None of this required any heavy investment. The system was as it is, and you were able to spray the same half the volume of water on nearly twice the area. Now, if you spoke to any of the Udas here, they would say that Apoor Uda or Sachin Uda, that any good effort at PLM does basically the same thing, that you are taking the same volume of water and you are benefiting often twice, three times more farmers. So the critical need is for improving, or for proactive, not even improving, because at present there is hardly any management in India's canal irrigation system. There is need for some modicum of management effort. If you look at the literature, you have either found problems with the bureaucracy, irrigation bureaucracy is unresponsive, top-down, and so on and so forth. Or you have found problems with the farmers, or you have found problems with decrepit irrigation system, which is kind of high and deferred maintenance. But actually the problem is in the relationship between the three. So there is a certain well-performing irrigation system, which is what I found in Xijing, where Rao Tukping in China, which is kind of recently modernized, it looks like a designer irrigation system with perfectly, you know, cement concrete lined channels going up right to the farmer's field. And all these were actually ditches before modernization, because now area irrigation systems are very poorly built. They're just earthwork. But now those systems are kind of, you know, pin up irrigation systems. But along with that, there is also institutional modernization. There are water user associations which collect $75 to $400 per hectare as irrigation fee. So these relationships have been taken care of. The irrigation agency takes responsibility of providing irrigation service of quality and maintain system in pin-up condition. The farmers pay reasonable irrigation service fee, provide labor when there is needed in maintaining the channels below the outlet, and is compliant with rules and norms. When this happens, then the system produces a significant amount of GDPs, welfare. Now, I think it's these relationships that are broken down in Indian irrigation systems after, you know, our irrigation systems used to perform pretty much like Chinese irrigation systems today during the colonial era. But after independence, there has been a systematic deterioration. Now, the way I could be thinking of this is what? Is that you expect that there would be a groundswell of impetus to change the system from within. It's unlikely. Irrigation systems are large public systems. They have changed generally in response to stimuli or impetus from outside. So the way these relationships are structured depends upon these four parts of the external task in mind. The nature of the state, the nature of society, the state of technology, in the scale of institutions. And unless there is an impetus to change from any of this core outside, we should not expect the irrigation bureaucracy to change its behavior or the farmers to change their behavior. So how do public utilities reinvent themselves to remain relevant in a changing time? And our tentative hypothesis is that it is not, the answers are not within those systems. The answers are outside. Because external conditions seem to explain why canal irrigation in India was farmers centric to agriculture and livelihoods in the pre-colonial, in the colonial and pre-colonial period than they are now. To verify this, we went to China, this new modernized irrigation system, and I could see everything that I would like to see in Indian irrigation systems. I think farmers must have found $400 a hectare to see an irrigation. But if Indian irrigation systems collect even $40 per hectare, I think they will become, you know, much better. Would this, would such a thing possible be possible in India for Indian irrigation systems or in any Indian public system? The example that we found of that was the turnaround of the electricity board in Gujarat. And we didn't have the Water Institute, we have no interest in power. But we've been closely following the power sector in Gujarat, primarily because it's a public utility which has been undergoing massive transformation. Now, there are marked similarities between a power utility and a canal system. Both have rivers, in one there is a reservoir, in another there is a generation plant. Both have transmission systems, there are thousands of customers. All the chicanery happens at the distribution level, you know, at the headboards and the transmission level, there is no problem. Main canals you can manage. It is at the farmer end that all kind of trouble occurs. Both are dealing with valuable resources. Until 2000, the Gujarat electricity board was as bad as any of the irrigation systems anywhere in India. But today, Gujarat electricity has become a model. Why? Was it because streams of change came from within? No. We just got a new chief minister for whom 24/7 power supply was an important central part of the political strategy. So there were pressures from outside the utility, which actually inspired or talked about or generated the power of the change. So this we have outlined in highlight number 6. Then Samaj and I did, we did some field work in Sri Lanka. It was a very short field work and Samaj will make a presentation on that. But Sri Lanka, as you all know, has a very old traditional system of community irrigation management. But after the independence, Sri Lankan irrigation institutions had also decayed. But by around 2005, the current president, he decided to channelize all the fertilizer subsidy through water user associations. And our impression during our field visit was that this single measure infused new life in the water user association, because the president's leaders of water user association were now more easily able to get compliance from farmers in, you know, maintaining common channels in tanks and so on and so on. Neither in China, nor in Gujarat electricity, or nor in Sri Lankan water user association was institutional turnaround spontaneous and internal. The impetus for change came from external task. So this leads us to this hypothesis that there is no best way to organize or manage the canal irrigation system or to improvise its performance. Instead, the optimal course of action is probably contingent upon what the external and internal conditions are. So if you look at different parts of Asia, there are different contingencies that determine the priorities for canal irrigation management. And that changes the notion of irrigation system performance and growth. So when we were doing the planning commission task force, when we were trying to figure out what can be done to shift the emphasis of planning and investment from construction to management. So we thought that this is the vicious circle that has gripped the Indian irrigation industry. There is no irrigation service, we have poor connection, which has led to lack of resources for operation and management, and the loss of moral right of farmers to demand service, and the will to organize what these resources. Which in turn has led to the breakdown in the accountability loop between the irrigation managers and the farmers, mounting deferred maintenance and systematically poor irrigation service, again, because of poor irrigation service, you can't demand irrigation service. And we thought that this new fund that the Planning Commission has recommended would attack this group here. That if you create incentives for state irrigation agencies to lay a serious irrigation service fee and increase collection to from current 10% of demand to 80-90% of demand, then you would at once solve the problem of lack of resources with the irrigation manager to do upkeep of the system, and you would also create among farmers a will to demand better service. If you're paying 400 rupees per hectare, then you're going to make sure that you get some irrigation before you pay any irrigation. So that may be one way of, so it would attack here, it could also hurt, attack here, and it is, that is something that could actually break this vicious circle and lead to. So there is a 6,700 crore question of whether state irrigation departments will buy this, whether it will actually generate strong enough incentive for them to do the current some work of collecting irrigation service. Will NIS incentives work behind it? And how does the, what is the best way to respond to farmer-led modifications in irrigation? And the study that Meghna led basically